Welcome back to Lift Every Voice. Gerard Henry chilling with my man, Darwin Hobbs, who I am really a big fan of, for real. Darwin, now you was dropping some heavies on worship, you know, and I definitely want you to talk to the people. But before we go back to that, how did you arrive to that place? Because a lot of people obviously compared you to Luther in terms of your sound and all of that.
Right, and they still do.
And so, but to me, you kind of shifted even from some of that stylistically, just a little bit.
Yeah.
And but how did you arrive to the place of worship from when you first started out in the industry?
I mean, I'm just like probably 90% of the people that you know. I mean, I grew up in church. I grew up in a Baptist church.
Okay.
And you know, I started out, again, worship for me, it was totally just music. Actually, it wasn't even worship, it was devotion.
Right.
Where you had five deacons and a one chair. And like Bishop Long was just talking about that the other week. Five deacons, one chair, and we sang some songs, and that was it. There was devotion. But then after I left that denominational church, I started attending a non-denominational church. And then that's when I started, you know, teaching about, you know, praise and worship. And I would even say that I progressed past that, because I had begun to do something I call worship.
Ah, go ahead and break that down.
You know, so, and I built a tabernacle in a space where I felt like worship was, you know, only something that we really did between 10 and 12 on Sunday, and we'd shout, and we'd two fast songs and one slow song. You know, the slow song is worship. Two fast songs is praise.
Right.
Hogwash. That's what I called worship, okay? So I just began a process. When you say, how did I arrive at where I am now? I just began a process of unlearning.
Okay.
Unlearning, and I think that that's really something that the Father wants all of us to do in this particular dispensation of time, is to, and I keep looking at the camera because I want to know that I'm talking to you guys too. I really want to, I think that what He wants is for us to go through a season of unlearning some of the things that we've, you know, built our tabernacle and we camped out at these places for long enough, because a great deal of what we've done, when the Father, the Bible says the Father is seeking those that will worship Him in spirit and in truth. To worship Him in spirit, we know what that is, and to worship Him in truth, truth meaning something you know, using your mind in the soulish realm. He even wants our soulish realms to worship Him, our bodies, our minds, our souls, our wills, and our intellect, and all that. But to say that you worship in truth doesn't necessarily mean what we do nowadays. A lot of people, they worship in sincerity, but that's not necessarily true. There's a lot of people that worship things sincerely, like Buddhist, and I'm gonna not name a lot of, I don't want to offend anybody, but people worship a lot of what they call God sincerely, but they're sincerely wrong. If the only thing true worship, this is my opinion, the only true worship is worship that lines up with the Word of God, and that is based on the Bible. It's what I call truth. And so I just began to unlearn a lot of stinking thinking, as I call it. And so, and after that, I began to study God's Word and find out what touched the heart of God. And I began to lead in Psalms 51, and when it says, and I know I sound real deep and religious, but I'm not, I'm just keeping it real. We're talking about worship.
Right.
And we're talking about true worship. And so I began to come across things like Psalms 51, where it says the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit.
Right.
And a contrite heart that God will not despise. You know, and that I began to learn things like brokenness is the prerequisite. And when you also ask me how I come to this place, it came from joining myself with covenant relationships, you know, getting mentors and having people teach me, like John Stevenson, a pastor from Cincinnati, Ohio, who taught me a great deal of what I know. And I use tools, you know, outside of the Bible, I use books that were written by people who, you know, Judson Cornwall and Joseph Garlington and Helena Barrington, and, you know, and I went to one time, I guess I could say it was a, I should put a big fat marker in this point in my life. I went to something called a prophetic music conference in Atlanta, Georgia, and the Johnsons. It's a big family there. Bishop Glenn Johnson and his brothers. They have a conference called the Prophetic Music Conference, and I went to that conference and it changed my life. And that's where I actually met Joseph Garlington. A lot of people and that was years ago. But it just
opened you up.
Absolutely.
It gave you a foundation to build upon.
Absolutely.
But it seems like now, and I believe it's a God thing, worship is just, it's pervading wherever you go.
Right.
What do you feel like God is doing in the hearts of believers to cultivate this appetite for worship?
Well, again, I like what you said when you said it's pervading. But I think that we have to be careful, because I think that, again, the thing that's being perpetuated is worship that is from 10 to 12. And that's not, that doesn't equate to relationship the rest of the week.
Right.
And like intimacy and relationship, it requires time, quality time. And so I think a great deal of, again, what we're calling worship is we're depending on the presence of the Lord that's ushered in through different
through service.
But the presence of the Lord should not just be ushered in.
Right.
We need to move it. I think that God's moving us in a time where we are living with the promised presence of the Lord. He said in his word that where there's two or three gathered, there am I.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so that's the promised presence of the Lord.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Okay, and I'm not deep. I learned these things from reading two. There's a great book called Exploring Worship by Bob Sorge. And Sorge, I don't know how you pronounce his name. S-O-R-G-E. Plug for Bob. But I mean, there's a thing called the promised presence of God, where God has promised his presence to us in the Bible.
Uh-huh.
And then there's what we have in church now, which is what we'd say we usher in the presence of the Lord. But guess what? That's not totally error-proof.
Right.
Because guess what? What if William Murphy, a Byron Cage, a Darwin Hobbs, what if we in a place where we whack that Sunday morning and we don't feel like even ushering any presence of the Lord in?
Right, right.
Then what are the people gonna do? So what's happening is the parishioners, they're using church as what we call a filling station.
All right, right.
Horrible term. I know we've been saying that for years. Church is a filling station. You got to move past that. Because guess what? If you come in and everybody's coming in, just like last week when Katrina hit in Atlanta, a great deal of the gas stations ran out of gas. You know why? Because there were people on the radio saying that we're going to have a gas shortage. Okay, so everybody ran out at one time, filled up their car with gas.
Mm-hmm.
Then, actually what they were saying is from the FEMA or whoever, they were saying, this is not true. There are gas sources. We're not going to run out of gas. But what made it true, what made it come to pass is that everybody ran out and filled up their cars because they were nervous.
Right.
So then the gas ran out. Same thing we call church a filling station. Everybody's coming in on Sunday mornings, sucking the life out of the small remnant of people who are really worshiping with their life.
And they should be bringing worship.
That's right.
Filling the house.
Making a deposit.
They should be filling the house.
Absolutely.
I'm in there with you, bro. I'm in there with you. All right?
Right. Hey. That's what I'm talking about.
I'm getting ready to drop another heavy question on them in a minute. Stay tuned for more on Lift Every Voice. Get ready. It's coming.
I'm ready. I'm waiting.
There's nobody like Jesus. There's nothing like his plan for my life. There's nothing like the words that he's spoken over me. Oh.
There's nobody like Jesus.
There's nothing like the love that he shows. Nothing like his grace and his mercy. I am so grateful. Nobody like Jesus.
There's nobody like Jesus.
No, there's nobody quite like Jesus. Nobody that can save me like he could. That can heal my body, raise me from the dead.
Nobody that can turn my life around, turn my frown into a smile, and give me hope again, hope again.
There's nobody like you.
Ooh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's nothing like his plan for me.
Nothing like his plan for
There's
my life.
Like the words that he's for.
Nothing like the words that he's for.
There's nobody like Jesus.
There's nobody like Jesus.
There's nothing like the love that he shows.
Shirley, I searched all over the world. I can't find anybody like Jesus.
Nobody.
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 Nobody. No. No, 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 no.
There's nobody like Jesus.
And nobody can save me like
Jesus. Nobody
a
man. Like Jesus.
Nobody can raise me
nobody
like
Jesus. Nobody like Jesus.
I wouldn't serve a God.
Nobody.